But we've also got to have an answer about the people who want to know, do you hear me now? And that comes down to human potential. Comes down to understanding that in the 19th century, what made for greatness was what you could dig out of the ground, your resources. What made for greatness in the mid-20th century was how many widgets could you run along an assembly line? How efficient were your industrial processes? But here in the 21st century, it really is about human potential. And can you really capture the human potential of all? The United States has been the most extraordinary country at capturing human potential and mobilizing it. And it's done so because it is not a country that is organized on the basis of nationality, religion, our ethnicity. In fact, Americans' ancestors have come from every corner of the globe. There are hyphens all across Mexican Americans and German Americans and Korean Americans and Chinese Americans. They've come from everywhere. And they've come to be a part of an idea that you can come from humble circumstances and you can do great things. That it doesn't matter where you came from, it matters where you're going. And that's led people to come here for generations, whether they came to make $5, not 50 cents, or whether they came like Sergey Brin's parents when he was 7 years old from Russia. He found Google. He would never have done it in Russia. And so immigration, which is a controversial subject these days, yes, laws are important. Compassion is also important. And a recognition that without immigration, the United States has the same sclerotic demographics of Europe and Japan and Russia. And so remaining a country in which we the people is an expansive concept is important. But you know, we the people has never just been about people who came here. It's also about people who were born here. And there, the importance was that you were not a prisoner of your class. You were able to go from the lowest to the highest in one generation. But it was always access to a high quality education that made that possible. In my family, this is an article of faith. I'm not even the first PhD in my family because of my grandfathers. One who was not college educated, but educated all five of his kids, my mother's father, and my granddaddy Rice on my father's side. Who, when he was a young man in Utah, that would be E-U-T-A-W, I'm not kidding, Alabama, he decided he was going to get book learning in a college. And so he asked how a colored man could go to college. They said, well, you could go to Little Stillman College. It's a Presbyterian school down the road. So he saved up his cotton. He went to Stillman College. And after his first year, they said, so how are you going to pay for your second year? He said, I'm out of cotton. They said, you're out of luck. But thinking pretty quickly, he said, so how are those boys going to college? They said, well, they have what's called a scholarship. And if you wanted to be a Presbyterian minister, you could have a scholarship too. And my grandfather said, you know, that is exactly what I meant in mind. And my family has been college educated and Presbyterian ever since. Now, he knew that that was going to transform him and generations. My father would become college education. My Aunt Teresa, she would go to the University of Wisconsin, get a PhD in 1952 in Victorian literature. She would write books on Dickens. You think what I do is weird for a black person? She wrote books on Dickens. But today, when I can look at your zip code, and I can tell whether you're going to get a high quality education, can I honestly say, it doesn't matter where you came from, it matters where you're going. That you can come from humble circumstances and do great things. The greatest challenge to the United States of America is actually not what they can do to us, but what we're doing to ourselves. Creating two societies, one capable and one not. And that is the problem with Do You Hear Me Now? The answer to Do You Hear Me Now is one that we don't really want to hear. It's no more third graders who can't read. It's no more 18-year-olds who have no skills. It's no more 20-year-olds, 21-year-olds, 22-year-olds who get a college degree and have lots of debt, but no job applicable skills. There can't be any more 35-year-olds who can't be retrained. And oh, by the way, as business people, it's also my hope that part of the answer to "Do you hear me now?" is a recognition that yes, automation is a terrific thing, but before you automate your workforce out of existence, perhaps to think about workforce development and how people can be a part of the future. Because it all comes down, ultimately, for the United States to be the confident leader of that international order that served us so well. We are not lacking in economic power. We are not lacking in military capability. But we are lacking in confidence. Confident country, it was a confident country that was able to say an attack upon one is an attack upon all, despite Soviet power. It was a confident country that said, we will share our GDP with you so that we can all be more prosperous. It was a confident country that believed in free markets and free peoples. It was a confident country that tried to protect that system, sometimes failing, sometimes in ways that were not so smart, but always with the belief that America's interests and values relate. That was a confident country. That confidence has to come from within. And in that sense, the populists are right. But their prescription, which is not just that you need to pay attention to what's going on at home,